So this session comes to an end, and next chairperson is here, and speakers will come.
Research paper publications and presentations in her name at national and international level. We welcome you, ma'am. I would now request Professor K.S. Sharma to accord a floral welcome to our chairperson for the session. Thank you, sir. I now request Dr. Rashmi Sisodia to take her seat on the dais. The organizers for inviting me to chair this session. I think this is the last session of the today first day conference on the recent trends in microwave techniques and optical communication. Now, as I am a zoologist and working with the looking into the effects of microwaves in the animal models resulting of mice. I don't know much of physics, I'm telling you before only. I don't know much of physics, I'm looking into those effects. And so, I would like to tell you that please don't use your mobile phones, especially when you are driving, because the metallic body of the car, it amplifies the waves coming from it 100 times. And your EEG is altered. One telephone call you make alters your EEG for 7 days. So be cautious while using mobiles in your cars while driving. Otherwise also it breaks your concentration and there are chances of accidents also. So be very, very cautious while using your mobile phones. Then secondly, if possible, don't install TVs in your bedrooms. If possible, do not install TVs in your bedroom, and even if you are installing, then switch off when you are sleeping. Simple, some precautions you have to take because you cannot escape the technology, and this has become a part of our lifestyle. We cannot escape it, but we should be judicious and we should not try it in our children handling the mobiles. Using their mobile, see, my child can handle the mobile, he's playing games on it, we should not encourage it at all. The children, because as sir also said, that children are more sensitive because their skull is very thin in comparison to the adults. So the waves penetrate more and they are being affected more. And the effects you will not see immediately, the biological effects you will not see immediately, it may be 10 years, 20 years after your use of mobiles. And so many publications, so many researches are there which say that there is increased risk of cancers, all types of cancers, breast cancer, neurological disorders, behavior, dizziness, and all these are the symptoms of these uses of the mobile phones. So please be judicious before you use them. Look into the dangers, hazards of it and then use it. I don't say don't use it, but be cautious about it. So today in this first session, we have Shubhra Mathur, who will be presenting simulating scattering coefficient from major dielectric constant of tiles. And Shubhra Mathur
presenting a paper on simulating scattering coefficient from major dielectric constant of terrestrial analog of lunar soil and earth soil at different percentage of moisture content. These are the main contents of the presentation. That what is the main objective of this paper, then the introduction, then how we have prepared the sample for measuring the dielectric constant using the different techniques, then the method of measurement for calculating dielectric constant, then its result, then from the measured dielectric constant we have simulated the scattering coefficient, and we have used here the Du Bois model, then some facts about the scattering coefficients, then its results and the conclusion. The main objective of this paper is to measure the dielectric constant of the terrestrial analog of lunar soil. As we know that there were many manned missions on the moon, so they have brought many of the lunar samples. And due to the limited amount of lunar samples, the NASA has prepared the terrestrial analog of lunar soil, which is exactly same as of the lunar soil. And with this, we have used the different types of earth soil. As we know, on the earth, basically there are three types of soils are present, that is sandy, silt, and clay soil. After this, we have varied the percentage of moisture content. And after this, calculating the dielectric constant with the help of the waveguide cell method, we have simulated the scattering coefficient. Here we have used different types of soil, as I told you, and for calculating the complex dielectric constant, we have used the waveguide cell method. As Sir Dr. Chakravarti sir has told that on Chandrayaan-1 we are having one of the payload, that is the mini SAR, and in addition to this, we have another payload of the NASA, that is the mini RF, which was on board on the LRO. These payloads are working on the similar operating frequency, that is 2.38 GHz. And for this, we have the main aim of this paper is we have to calculate the dielectric constant, how dielectric constant varies with the percentage of moisture. So these measurements were carried out over at 2.38 GHz. And we know that these both SAR is working on the hybrid polarimetric mode. Here, the hybrid polarimetric mode means that it transmits the circular signal and receive the signal in the linear signal in the form of horizontal and the vertical polarization. Here this flowchart shows that first we have taken these different types of soil and overnight this soil at 110 degrees centigrade for 24 hours. After this overnight samples are then filled in the waveguide cell. These samples are filled in the waveguide cell such that the waveguide cell should be smooth. The sample should be smooth. It should not be, the roughness should be eliminated. If the roughness will be there, then it will vary the dielectric constant property. Then after this waveguide cell has put on the microwave bench, which operates at 2.38 GHz, and these measurements were carried out by varying the different percentage of moisture content, that is from 0 to 25% at this cap of the 5%. As we know, in the literature, the dielectric constant of the material, which is in powder form, can be carried out by the waveguide cell method, resonant cavity method, and vector network analyzer and coaxial probe. Here in the image, you can see that this is the test bench which we have used for calculating the dielectric constant. And here, this cell, we have put, this is the waveguide cell, which is used for 2.38 GHz. And we have different types of waveguide cell which varies according to the depth. This waveguide cell which we use is of 0.75 cm of depth. After calculating the dielectric constant, this table shows the result. Here we can see that as the percentage of water content is increasing, the dielectric constant is also increasing and the loss factor is also increasing. Then calculating this dielectric constant, we have calculated the density. Then we have normalized this dielectric constant according to the density, and this normalized dielectric constant is at 1 gram per centimeter cube. This is of the terrestrial analog of lunar soil. Here we can see that at 0% of water content, and these all measurements are carried out at the room temperature, and that time the temperature was at least plus 35 degrees centigrade. Here we can see that at 0% of water, the storage factor of the terrestrial analog of lunar soil, that is 3.9, and it goes on varies on. This next table is showing the dielectric constant of the sandy soil. And here we can see that in the sandy earth soil, the percentage of the sand percentage is more as compared to the clay and silt. That's why it is classified under the category of the sandy soil. And here we can see that the dielectric constant is also 3.05. This table is showing the silty or soil. The dielectric constant at this percentage of water is also increasing with the water content is increasing, and the dielectric constant is 3.40. And the last table is showing of the clay earth soil. At the clay earth soil, the dielectric constant is at 0% of water is 2.97. So from all these measurements, we can say that the moon has been evolved from the earth only. And this dielectric constant measurement is showing the giant impact hypothesis, which scientists have believed that. And from the calculating the dielectric constant, that is the electrical parameter of the soil, we can see that the moon has been evolved from the earth. Here, these are the graphs which shows the range of the types of analog and different types of earth soil varies from 0 to 25% only. And after adding 25% of moisture content by weight, we can say that the layer has been obtained over the sample cell, because the capacity, the absorption capacity of the soil is at 25% only. After that, it's not possible for any of the soil, either terrestrial analog or earth soil, it cannot absorb the water. And this is the storage loss factor. After calculating this dielectric constant, the scattering coefficient has been calculated, and as we know that scattering coefficient is function of wavelength, polarization and the incidence angle. And the nominal incidence angle which we have choose for simulating the scattering coefficient is 35 degree at the incidence angle of 35 degree and 49 degree. Why we have chosen this incidence angle? Because these are the nominal incidence angle of the mini star and the mini RF. And we have used the basically the Dubois model. Here these equations are of Dubois model, which is applicable from 2 to 11 gigahertz frequency. And here the KH is giving us the roughness factor. And for our calculating purpose, as I told you earlier, that the samples are put in such a way that the roughness should be minimized. So for calculating this roughness, we have used here 0.1 value. There is one basic fact which we came from the both the SAR data, that while using the mini SAR and mini RF, it gives some of the inconsistency over the same target property. Why it is so? Because mini SAR is constantly giving the value of LH high as compared to LP, while mini RF is not giving. So we are working on the same site also using different radar data, and we have carried out such experiment which proves that the vertical polarization should always be higher as compared to the horizontal polarization. So here this graph is from the ULABI, and here you can see that they have also carried out some of the theoretical and the experimental value, which shows that the L, that is VV polarization, should always be higher than the LH polarization. Then from Dubois model, we have also simulated the scattering coefficient, and here you can see that we are also getting the LV is always higher as compared to LH, that is for the mini star at 35 degree incidence angle. And this is for mini RF at 49 degree incidence angle. And it varies, the scattering coefficient is varies. So from here I can conclude that the moon has been evolved from earth, which support the giant impact theory. And here we can say that the scattering coefficient, the vertical polarization should always be higher than the horizontal polarization.
Uncertainty?
It is plus minus 1, not 1, plus minus 0.5
percent.
Yes, sir. Not more than that. We are carrying out the resonant cavity method, which is more accurate as compared to the waveguide cell method. We are in process of doing that.
And what is the reason you say polarization more data than the horizontal wide?
Sir, because for the horizontal polarization, the energy, the scattering which we are getting is get absorbed as compared to the vertical polarization, because for the vertical polarization we are getting the point contact also, and for using both the SAR data which was flown on the lunar surface in 2008 and 2009, we are calculating, we have selected many of the craters on the lunar poles, and we are seeing that the mini SAR is constantly giving the LH component is always higher than the LV component over the same target property, and even there the internal structure of both the SAR is also same. Then why this inconsistency? If there is such inconsistency, then in future we are trying to quantify the total amount of water ice on the lunar poles. So the main, if the main scattering coefficient values are inconsistent with each other, then it's not possible for us to do that. That's why we are waiting for the Chandrayaan 2 mission, which will work on the fully polarimetric mode and which will remove this ambiguity of hybrid polarimetric mode.
So thank you, Shobhananon. Myself, Shruti Singhal from International Center for Radio Science, Jodhpur. The topic is tracing variability of surface soil moisture over Rajasthan using SMOS. This is a quick background which the topics would I will cover. First of all, the soil moisture. Generally, soil moisture is water held in space between soil particles. Now, for a farmer, the concept of soil moisture is different, but it differs from person to person. Like for a water resource manager, it is different, and for the weather forecaster, the meaning of soil moisture is different. So the main, this quantity can be used in various applications, such as for climate monitoring, flood and drought prediction forecasting, studies of ecology or biogeochemical cycles, crop yield monitoring also can be studied. And in addition to this, this soil moisture parameter act as a descriptor of balance between the precipitation and evaporation cycle, we can say. Now, why, by which frequency we can study this soil moisture parameter from space, and why we are using the specific L-band frequency? The microwaves are sensitive to the presence of moisture in soil. As sir has already explained, that microwaves have the capability of penetrating the soil, and L band is one of the frequencies which can penetrate up to 5 cm layer, the topmost layer. And we are using the SMOS satellite, which is working at 1.4 GHz, that is the L band frequency. This is the SMOS satellite, this is ESA's mission. And it was launched on 2nd November 2009. It was duration is minimum 3 years, but still date it is continuing, and it is also said that 5 more years it will continue. The instrument, the microwave radiometer, that is MIRAS onboard it is. It works on L band, that is 1.4 GHz. The spatial resolution is 40 kilometers. The revisit time is 3 days. Here we have taken this SMOS satellite data. These are the three analyzing tools we have used. The ESOP ANGI software is used to see the futuristic passes of SMOS satellite. This is needed to collect the in-situ data, that is the ground truth data. The EULISA software is being used to download the data, the order the data or download, and BEAM software is the visualization software. This basic project was given by IMD to International Center for Radio Science. In this we are having 9 test sites. In this paper I have covered only the Rajasthan test site particularly. Now basic, in this we have downscaled the data of SMOS satellite, which was a low resolution data, using the MODIS data. We have taken NDVI and land surface temperature from MODIS, which is available at 1 kilometer. And we have combined it with the SMOS low resolution brightness temperature data to obtain high resolution data. This is the basic methodology. In this we can see the SMOS is providing the low resolution data. This is the brightness temperature and this is the soil moisture values. Here we have taken the MODIS data, NDVI data. We have aggregated the 1 kilometer data at 20 kilometer to obtain a regression coefficient similar to the SMOS resolution. And then after obtaining the regression coefficient, then we have, using this regression coefficient, we have downscaled this brightness temperature to 1 kilometer brightness temperature. And finally, we have mapped the soil moisture data obtaining from the brightness temperature available here. These are some of the maps which we have mapped over Rajasthan, and we have compared these maps from the IMD rainfall maps available on website. This is for August 2013, and we can find similarity between both the maps. The red color shows the lowest moisture, and the dark blue colors show the highest moisture available there. Similarly, we have done for months, 4 to 5 months, this analysis. These are different dates, graphs. Here we can see that as MODIS is an optical satellite sensor, that so due to cloud cover, the data was not available. As we are combining for getting the high resolution with MODIS and optical satellite, so this is a drawback. So we are working to use an passive sensor, that is from the SSMIS, to overcome this so that we can obtain the data under cloud cover conditions also. And the conclusion for this paper would be that you combining both the optical data and the microwave data synergetically, we can obtain the high resolution soil moisture maps. And these maps, we have seen that when comparing with the IMD rainfall data, are found in good agreement. And this indicates that the surface soil moisture can be estimated with good accuracy using the space-borne passive microwave sensor operating at 1.4 GHz. These are the references. Thank you.
Questions, any?
Did you compare your data with any one which is simulated in a simulated scenario? Have you compared your data with any other those? Have you got any data sheet for this data?
Yes, sir, we have.
What is the variation of the director constant data?
It's a director constant.
Of the soil, how much you are getting at the helmet?
Say 2 to 3.
2 to 3?
No. Yes. Sir, off. Sir, dry soil, I am talking.
For the dry soil, okay. But yes, for the wet soil?
Say it goes up to 5. So most, it saturates up to.
No. Just 2.
Sir, we have taken, sir, over Rajasthan this time.
No, it's okay, but if you have had 18 to 20.
Sir, that we have found over that Kerala site we have taken. There, sir, the data is not available due to the cloud cover conditions. So we are trying to solve it using the SSMI now. Like, we are using MODIS this time. So MODIS is having problem during the cloud cover. So now we use the SSMI so that we can combine both the data.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself Kitansh Kulati from BIT Mishra Jaipur campus, and the topic of my discussion is design of triple resonant rectangular microstrip patch antenna with 4 symmetrical rectangular slots for VLAN and WiMAX applications. The contents are as follows: the objective, then introduction, conventional rectangular microstrip patch, then the modified rectangular microstrip patch and conclusion, and the enhancement and the thereafter references. The objective which we actually discussed was to prepare the microstrip patch antennas for C-band application, wherein there was a range between 4 GHz to 8 GHz covering VLAN, WiMAX and IMT bands, and a bandwidth of more than 10% for the preliminary bandwidth, more than 10%, and gain more than 2 dB at the starting. What are microstrip patch antennas? We'll be discussing this among the following. Microstrip patch antenna, it consists of a patch on one side of the dielectric substrate and a ground plane on the other side of the dielectric substrate. The patch can be of various sizes, that is triangular, circular, rectangular, the ring patch, based on the application and the polarization we need, the circular, the horizontal polarization and etc. Moreover, the microstrip patch have been used everywhere because of the planar structures and the conformity and the miniaturization that is achieved the microstrip patch. There are the various advantages and disadvantages, that is the thin profile, lightweight, low cost, and supports multi-frequency operation. In communication, actually, we are dealing with various frequencies, and if we can design an antenna where many different frequencies can be built, multi-band antennas can be used, and it will be of great help. So microstrip antennas give us this opportunity. It can be made compact and can be made conformable, as discussed in the previous slide. There are some disadvantages which we need to overcome. That is the low gain, the small bandwidth, the low temperature tolerance, low power handling capacities, and these are some of the disadvantages which we need. Actually, the research is going on. And the recent applications of microstrip antenna, aircraft and ship antenna, missiles, satellite, mobile communications, biomedical, everywhere. The software which we are using is the IE3D software, and it includes a technique, method of movements, wherein the Green's function is used. In method of movement, the surface currents are used to model the microstrip patch, and volume polarization currents in the dielectric slab are used to model the fields in the dielectric slab. An integral solution is formulated for the unknown currents on the microstrip patches and the field lines and their images in the ground plane. The integral equations are transformed into algebraic equations that can be easily solved using a computer. This method takes into account the fringing field outside the physical bounding of the two-dimensional patch, thus providing a more exact solution. There are many microstrip feed techniques like coaxial prop feed, microstrip line feed, aperture coupled, and proximity coupled feed. These are the non-conducting feed that are discussed at the later on. In our project, we'll be using the coaxial prop feed, in which the conductor coaxial prop feed, in which a SMA conductor protrudes to the dielectric substrate and is soldered on the pinpoint soldered on the microstrip patch. This is easy to manufacture, so that's why this technique is more helpful. The feed can be placed at any desired location inside the patch in order to match with the input impedance, and is easy to fabricate, and there are moreover low spurious radiations. Disadvantages are non-planar structure that the SMA connector protrudes outside the dielectric substrate. In the simulation, we'll be using this like the flow chart, antenna shape selection, then we'll enter the parameters, then the field location and field radius, then enter meshing frequency and highest frequency, then the strip frequency and lowest frequency should be entered, then the simulation is carried on and the results are analyzed. And if the desired results are not with us, convenient, then the same process is repeated again with a hidden trial method. This was a conventional rectangular patch, and the substrate we used was the FR4 substrate because of the low cost, where the dielectric permittivity is 4.4 and the loss standard of 0.025. The dimensions of the patch are 29.57 mm into 38.08 mm. This patch actually resonates at 5.489 GHz with a reflection coefficient of -33.93, and the gain was 3.56. The VHWR, as we all know, is less than 1.5, at 1.04, and the bandwidth was 2.9%. To increase this bandwidth, these are the results for the reflection coefficient and the Smith chart. The rear part of the impedance should be 50 ohms and the idle should be 0 ohms. To improve the bandwidth and the gain, we actually use the slotting techniques, in which the rectangular patch, the 4 slots were introduced. The length and the width of the slots were actually varied over and over, and then the results were analyzed based on the electric and magnetic field coupling. When the width was kept constant at 1.5 mm and the length was varied to 3, 10 and 6 mm, there were various results, and like as you can see, when we are increasing the length to 3, to 10, to 6, then the bandwidth is going increasing 2.5, 2.7, then 2.4 to 2.6, 3.5, 5.4 at the resonant frequency band which we are concerned into. Then keeping the width 2 mm constant, and increasing the length from 4.5, and then finally at 3.5, when the length was kept at 3.5, the bandwidth was 12.74, with the gain at 3.41 and 2.67, and the frequency is 5.28 and 5.55 GHz. And when the slot and the width and the length were kept variable, then there was inappropriate results were followed. This is a reflection coefficient graph with frequency. As you can see here, The slots basically which were introduced into this rectangular patch were, these slots actually changed the inductance and the capacitance values in the microchip. And because of this change in the capacitance and inductance, the Q factor increase. And when we increase the capacitance, the Q factor decreases, which is the cost, major cause for increase in the bandwidth. So when we observe the current distribution graph, the areas where we get the dielectric field more, there we introduce the slot to increase the capacitance. The discontinuity, as we can see, there's a 90 degree bend over here. This increases the capacitance over the circuit. And for many other slots, we can see there's a LC modeling or a quasi-static modeling which can be done to actually observe the slot structure. The variation of input impedance with the resonant frequency, as we can see over here, the input impedance was matched to the field line, that is 50 ohms, and the imaginary part was less than, say, 1.24, 1.22, and 1.04. The directivity up to 11.13 dBi has been achieved at resonant frequencies 5.55, 5.04, 7.24 dBi, 5.29, 10.49 dBi. The gain was, you can see, as follows, we have seen in the last slide. The E and the H plane patterns are at the various resonant frequencies are as follows. They are orthogonal to the patch and that's the microstrip property. The design triple band slotted rectangular patch antenna is operating in the frequency range 5 to 5.63 GHz. This antenna resonates at three frequencies, that is namely 5.04 GHz, 5.28 GHz and 5.55 GHz, covering the VLAN and WiMAX standards. The performance of the antenna is optimized considering the different slot variants and to obtain an antenna with enhanced bandwidth gain and directivity. And also a shift in the resonant frequency has been observed through various simulated results on changing the slot width. The design antenna represents a better gain and addition platform. And the further techniques which can be applied to the microchip antenna is a multi-layer technique in which we can reduce an air gap or any dielectric substrate. The stacking technique in which the two dielectric slabs are stacked over one another to increase the bandwidth and gain. And the air gap technique. I have been currently working on these techniques further. The bibliography and some other references which I have used. Thank you.
Questions?
29.92%.
Yeah, so why it is so less? There is a single patch we can get over 90%.
Because the gain at the negative frequency was negative.
Why, what is the reason for such a lower efficiency?
I think the losses are more with the FR4 substrate. Because when we
what is the cost?
0.0.0.25. It's not so bad. Okay, I have a question. Anyway, the study this. What is the achievement which you achieved? Because there are so many antennas that have been designed as yet.
Okay.
So what is the fresh, what is the achievement you have over the last? So this is actually the bandwidth from 2% to 12.74%. Microchip antenna, normally the conventional patch is having a bandwidth of 2 to 5% when we see the patch resonators. So by introducing the slots into it, we actually can introduce the inductance and the capacitance. We can change the inductance and capacitance if we observe the current distribution graph.
This has also been reported with a higher efficiency.
Yeah, it can.
So how do you want to improve upon
the efficiency? So there is a technique called DGR, defective ground structure, in which the ground is actually, we can reduce the defects into the ground of this microchip patch. And this can actually, it has been used in various GPS applications where the highly specific efficiency antennas have been used. And it will also, it also gives a multi-frequency antenna.
Doing MSc Physics from the IIS University Jaipur, and today's my topic is about analysis of 5-4-3 ring hexagonal PCF structures having the circular and the elliptical air holes, which is done under the supervision of Dr. Ritu Sharma, MNIT Jaipur. And my today's talk, plan of my presentation will be considered of introduction, the discussions and the results, conclusions, the future work and the applications,
for the PCL. Now, what is PCL? Photonic crystal fibers, which are first demonstrated in 1996 by the scientist Dr. Philip Brewster. And what are the photonic crystals? Are optical fibers that employ a microstructured arrangement of low index material in background of higher refractive index. The background material which is used is undoped silica, and the low index region is typically provided by the air void running along the length of the fiber. Why we use silica here? As it gives the high damage threshold, have low lower confinement, and the chemically very stable, and can be doped with any material or any various materials also. And what are the advantages of using the PCF? Allows for guidance through the hollow fibers, smaller attenuation. PCFs with the larger core may carry more power than the conventional fibers. Here the question arises, what are the difference between the conventional fibers and the PCFs? Standard fibers are solid fibers with the guiding mechanism which provides a region with a higher index than the surrounding material, where the PCF utilizes a microstructure of silica and air holes which provides the index difference. And the other advantages are control over the dispersion. The size of the air hole may be tuned to shift point of the zero dispersion into the visible region of the light. The fabrication method which I use is the opti-ablative method, which is consisted of the mode solver which is combined with the ablative software engine, and the simulation can be used for the model in field as the input directly. Also provide an independent mode solver to allow user to solve and study the mode outside an ablative calculation. Now, ablative software is a modeling technique in which we can solve the Maxwell equation by applying a finite difference mathematics. It is directly calculate the value of electric field and the magnetic field at the different point of the computational domain. The model analysis requires the two main steps, the creating the layout structures and calculating the modes. Here the how I solve the modes. Firstly, we define the material and the profile, which I use the silica having the refractive index of 1.46, and the channel which I use is air. Now creating the object, source and the monitor, and then we create the layout, which is considered of 4, 3 and 5 ring structures, and then having the simulation parameters of having wavelength 1.5, and then we run the simulation in the simulator. After that, we analyze the data in the analyzer. Now, proposed structures which I have proposed is for the circular rings and the elliptical rings. This is the structure for 5 ring, having the circular ring structure. It is having a major axis and the minor axis having the radius of 0.6 this and having a minor of 0.6 micrometers. The pitch which is taken is of 2.3 micrometer in both in the three of these structures. For the elliptical air holes, I have taken the major axis radius which is equal to 0.6 micrometer and the minor axis which is equal to 0.4 micrometers, and the pitch which is taken is the same as in the circular ring, which is 2.3 micrometers. The calculation of the mode which is done in the simulations, as mode solver will be perform a set of calculations sweeping the wavelength values. This is the field distribution. This is the field distribution for the 5 ring structure and the pattern. This is the graph active core which is described in the electric field, and this is for the magnetic field. This is for 4 ring and this is for 3 ring, in which I have analyzed that in 5 ring there is loss of confinement is very low, and in 3 ring there is so much of the loss. And then the effective refractive index which is have taken for the 5 ring, 4 ring and 3 ring in the case of the circular shape. This is the n effective values which I have taken from the model analysis, and these values come around the refractive index of the silica which is 1.43 and 1.45, and these are the wavelengths which I have taken from the 0.2 to 2, and I have concluded that 2 and 3 which are red and green lines are having the refractive index of 4 and 3, and this blue line is showing for the 5 ring structure for the circular, and the elliptical shape holes have having the same values of 5, 4 and 3. It means that circular ring structures, elliptical ring structures have very low confinement regard as compared to the circular ring. Applications of the PCFs consist of the fiber lasers and amplifiers, telecom components, fiber optic sensors, and the quantum optics, which is consisted of electromagnetic induced transparency or the guidance of the cold atoms. Conclusion, in this paper, I have concluded that the elliptical air holes are having a high birefringence, and the symmetry of the circular ring is very distorted as compared to the elliptical. Future work, dispersion is to be calculated for this, in which the this is for the waveguide dispersion, which I have calculated the n effective values of the 4, 5 and 3 rings. I have to put the value of refractive index with the as the lambda value here, and I have to calculate this dispersion, and the material dispersion will be calculated by the 3 term Salmer equation which is given. This I have the value of the coefficients here, a1, a2, a3 and the lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, and the value of the material is to be calculated, and the total chromatic dispersion will be calculated by the total of waveguide material plus the material dispersion. Here the loss of confinement is close to the unity for the silica mat. So the PCFs as the model are confined.
Thank you.
Instead of optical fibers which are we are generally using, the dispersion controlling, filtering and switching, these materials are used instead of optical fibers, standard fibers which are using in general, and in quantum optics, which is also general generation of the correlated photon pairs, electromagnetic induced transparency and the guidance of the cold atoms.
From JCRC University under the guidance of Dr. Manisha Gupta ma'am, and the title of my paper is New Generation Triangular Patch Antenna with Embedded Microsensors for Emerging 4G and 5G Wireless Communication Networks. The contents that I'll be discussing in my presentation includes introduction, WiMAX, antenna design, parameters, single feed and defective ground structure, microsensors, conclusion and references. Basically, antennas, they enable wireless communication between two and more stations by directing signals towards these stations by means of radiating or receiving radio waves. The need of wireless communication such as WiMAX has grown very rapidly today. This is because of their low profile, which needs smaller dimensions. And microstrip patch antennas is one of the best choices for wireless systems. The patch antennas are basically printed on a substrate up below the ground plane. There are many shapes of patches which are possible with varying applications, but the most popular are the rectangular, circular, and the thin strips. But among the shapes that have attracted the major attention is the triangular shape structure because of its small dimensions, as it has the advantage of occupying less metallized area on substrate other than the existing configuration. This rapid development of wireless communication has urged a wide demand for antennas having compact size and multi-band operations in WiMAX and WLAN standards. Basically, WiMAX is shortly described as a telecommunication standard which is aimed at providing wireless data over long distances, and it is based on IEEE 802.16 standard. It provides a speed for around 70 megabits per second with a 50 kilometers range. And this standard has the advantage of allowing wireless connections between BTS and LOS. The basic antenna shape that I have designed is an equilateral triangular patch first. The resonant frequency is calculated from this equation. These are the dimensions that I have used. I have used the substrate length as 48 mm. The equation that I've mentioned, the length of the patch comes out to be 35 millimeters. The substrate material I've used is FR4 epoxy because of its cost, and the thickness of the substrate is 1.59. This is the patch that I've designed with a single feed technique. And by this patch on 3.7 gigahertz, I got a return loss of -11.937 dB. On CST microwave studio tool, and the upper resonance occurs at 4.3 with a return loss of -23.18. The bandwidth in this case is very less, which is 534 megahertz, and the VSWR is 1.6875. This is the 2D and the 3D radiation patterns, which the gain is 3.321. Now, as we can see that the bandwidth in the simple triangular patch antenna is very less, so some defects are being introduced in the ground structure to increase its bandwidth so that its application increases. So a defective ground structure had been widely used in microstrip antennas for its size reduction, for reducing harmonics, for bandwidth improvement. What is a defective ground structure? It is basically an etched off portion in a ground plane of a microstrip coplanar or a conductor backend coplanar waveguide. It perturbs the current and results in a restricted excitation of electromagnetic waves. As it is shown, I have designed on the same dimensions, I have designed an equilateral triangular patch antenna, and on the ground, I have made a slot, I have introduced some defects in the ground structure. As we can see here that my bandwidth is now increased to 1.22 GHz and my VSWR value is improved and it is now 1.144. The gain here in this case is 1.735 decibels. This is the latest topic wherein some micro sensors have been introduced on the patch antennas to have more applications. The efforts towards multi-element antennas on sensor nodes have been augmented by the progress made in the area of ESAs. The sensors have the advantage over wired or active sensors. These type of sensors have a longer lifespan and reduce the maintenance cost and complexities. There are different substances basically which are placed on the patch which are embedded with the sensors to increase its applications. The purpose of this work was to simulate different geometry configurations of the coupling antenna to obtain the configuration that maximizes the coupling between the sensor and the antenna. And only by changing the value of the dielectric constant which is placed on above the sensor, we can have a wide range of values. It has been observed that the adding of defects in the ground plane gives better return loss and the bandwidth by using a single feed technique because it perturbs the current and results in a restricted excitation. The addition of wireless passive sensors have several advantages over wired or active sensors, and some of the chemicals which are added with the simulated dielectric constants are air, the sensor networks made of paradigm and millicube water. These are the references that I have gone through. Thank you. microsensors, I have only simulated the simple patches right now. I'll be working on it. Bandwidth is FH, the higher bandwidth.
You have defined it is the bandwidth. Yes, how you are defining the bandwidth?
The simple definition of bandwidth.
What is the definition?
The range of frequencies over it is the range of frequencies over the antenna operates. The minus 10 dBs, the range of frequency.
You are using minus 10 dB.
Minus 10 dB.
10 dB return bus.
Yes.
Nidhi Bhargav.
I am here to present a paper titled Temperature Dependence of Dielectric Properties of Barley, Chickpea and Mustard Seeds in Powder Form at Microwave Frequencies. A brief idea about the dielectric properties. Dielectric properties are the main parameters that provide information about how materials interact with electromagnetic energy. During heating by microwaves or high frequency electromagnetic radiation, many variables in food affect the heating performance. Dielectric properties of foodstuff depend upon the frequency of the electromagnetic radiation, temperature, moisture content, packing fraction, composition and density of the material. The dielectric properties can be expressed in terms of permittivity. Permittivity can be expressed as dielectric constant and dielectric loss. Dielectric constant is the measure of the ability of the dielectric material to store energy in the electric field, while dielectric loss gives an idea of the conversion of electrical energy into heat in dielectric material. Temperature of a material has a significant effect on the dielectric properties of a material. From the literature survey, it was apparent that temperature dependence of the dielectric properties of food grains like mustard seeds, barley and chickpea have not been reported at the frequency 3 GHz to 10 GHz. Therefore, it was considered by us to study these properties. About the material procurement, chickpea and barley grains were obtained from Durgapura Agriculture Station, while mustard seeds were procured from National Mustard Research Center, Sewar, Bharatpur. Preparation of the sample. It is difficult to measure the dielectric properties of the food grains in whole grain form because of the irregular shape of the grains and large air gaps which are formed. The measurement errors are reduced by using the grinded sample. So, in our present study, samples of all food grains were prepared by grinding the food grains and sieving them through sieves of mesh size 300 micrometers and 250 micrometers. So, the sample size that was considered was 250 to 300 micrometers. Methodology. Out of various techniques which are available, the method that we have used is the method which uses a waveguide cell and it measures the shift in the maxima and minima position when the sample is filled. A microwave bench consisting of klystron tube, power supply, attenuator, frequency meter and waveguide cell was used. The method which is proposed by Yadav and Gandhi, it was used. The equations, this is the theory behind. Gamma T represents the propagation constant, alpha is the attenuation and beta is the phase shift. So the values of beta and alpha were determined using these equations. The value of attenuation constant alpha was determined using this formula. This is the experimental arrangement that was used in the lab. This is a blue color constant temperature water bath which was used for the variation of temperature. The experiment was carried out at three frequencies, 4.65 GHz, 7.01 GHz and 9.42 GHz on the C band, J band and X band microwave benches respectively. These are the results that were obtained. So this shows the temperature dependence of dielectric constant and dielectric loss vector of barley at the three frequencies. If we look at this, we see that with the increase in the temperature, the value of both the dielectric constant and the dielectric loss are increasing. This shows the graphical representation of the values. We see that with the increase in the temperature, both the dielectric constant and dielectric loss, they show increase, a gradual increase. And if we look at the variation with frequency, it is observed that with the increase in the frequency, the value of the dielectric constant and dielectric loss decrease. The same trend was observed in the case of chickpea, wherein again the values of dielectric constant and dielectric loss, they show an increase with the increase in temperature. The pattern is approximately the same. But when the experiment was performed on the mustard seeds, the values showed a difference. Here, with the increase in the temperature, the value of dielectric constant decreases with increase in temperature, while the value of dielectric loss increased with increase in temperature. But a variation was observed at temperature 70 degree C. So, it was observed that the values in the case of mustard seed are different because they may contain a large amount of fat content, and hence the value was different. And as the temperature increases, the protein denaturation occurs, which further increases the structural deterioration of proteins. The resulting charge asymmetry causes increase in dielectric constant at higher temperature. If water becomes bound during denaturation process, the dielectric properties will decrease, and vice versa if water is released during denaturation.
Yes. Any questions from the audience?
Yes, sir. Three different batches.
Now, what is the reason that?